and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Today's gospel, remembering an exorcism that the Lord performed and the response that he got from the Pharisees. But I want to focus not on the miracle itself as much as what the problem was here about the Pharisees recognizing the Lord Christ. Because here we see that Christ is coming in, and by his own authority, he's casting out a demon, which was, in the time of the Jews, unheard of. Usually, a prophet needed to pray first, he needed to call on the power of God, but he couldn't, by his own authority, just walk up and command somebody to be healed or command somebody to be cleansed or purified from possession by a demon. And this is what I want to focus on, the problem of seeing things our own way, and our own way only. If we think about the Pharisees had certain expectations. And some of these expectations, they did not think were irrational. If you look at the history of the Jews, right, our Lord had created us to be in relationship with the whole entire world, and the world rejected him. So he kept on trying to outreach the world kept on rejecting. He made a covenant with Noah after restarting the world, and Noah's own descendants rejected him. And so he started a covenant with one person, which was Abraham. And the Jews, of course, are the descendants of Abraham. They're the descendants of Israel, which was Jacob. Now, our Lord had wanted from them a relationship. And in the things that he said that he was going to bless them with, one of the things that he said was that he was going to give them a land. He was going to give them an inheritance. He wanted to show them that they were his people, and one of the ways of showing this was that they had their own place of refuge. The problem is that people started to think that the point of the covenant was the nation. The point of the covenant was the gift. The point of the covenant was getting stuff. And so this became their focus. And they started to believe that if they didn't behave in a certain way, they won't get stuff. Does that sound familiar? This is something that we often do to either our parents, and almost all of us do with God. Where the point of our relationship with Christ, instead of being for the sake of the relationship of itself, instead of being for the very fact of his existence and that he's our Father, we tend to want to have a relationship with God because we think that means getting good marks, or we think that having a relationship with God means becoming a doctor or an engineer or whatever profession that you have in your mind. And that becomes our goal. And we also think that having a relationship with God means not having problems. And that's why we see that for many people, the first time something terrible happens in their life, that suddenly their faith in God is shaken. If there's a God, then how come my friend died? How come my family member died? How come this child got sick? How come this person got ran over by a car? How come this person got cancer? Suddenly, everything is gone because hardship came. As though the point of our relationship was to never go through hardship. So the Pharisees were expecting that when the Messiah came, that he would be a politician. They thought he would come and he would know how to speak the language of the land. He would know how to deal with the Romans who were occupying them. He would know how to reestablish them for a land. He would know how to raise himself up an army. They also thought he would be like them, a legalist. They thought he was going to come in and say, no, if you don't do this and you don't do this, then you're not allowed to come in. Something we do as well. Anybody who enters the sanctuary with their left foot instead of the right, God forbid, we scream at them like they're going to hell. This was legalism. It doesn't mean that there wasn't something good behind the ritual, but forgetting the point of the ritual and making the ritual the point instead of the God behind it. They thought that someone from their own ranks, or it would be a king. So they thought maybe it would be another Pharisee that would be the Messiah, maybe it would be a priest, or maybe it would be a king who sides with the Pharisees. That's how they viewed the Messiah. And for sure they thought it was somebody who's going to think as they do and agree with what they do. This was their scope of reference. This is how they saw the world. And in fact, we see in the readings of the Acts of the Apostles today a similar blunder. where the Pharisees, even it says that it was a specific sect of Pharisees who had become Christians, that they still are not able to let go of this I must be right complex. Because even after believing in Christ, even after Christ explicitly saying, no, you don't need to do all of these ritualistic things anymore, what are they doing? They are demanding that the new Christians that were pagans follow the rules of old Judaism. They need to be circumcised, they need to wash their hands, they need to do all sorts of rituals in order to call themselves Christians. But this is actually arrogance. It's looking as your scope of reference for the world as being yourself, your mind, your thoughts, your opinions, your views. It's you thinking you must be right. And we often do the same thing. We interpret things through our own lens always. And if people disagree with us, we perceive that they must be against us. If someone comes and tells us, well, don't you think maybe you're mistaken? Maybe the real understanding of it could be this. And our response is usually to assume that they want something from us, they're angry with us, they don't understand us. How many of us have that impression, oh, they just don't get me? It's like, no, there's a possibility that they get you, but there's also a possibility that you are simply wrong. We need to understand that. And sometimes we perceive it's the system that's against us. Otherwise, we would be happy. We might even have help right in front of us, but we refuse it because it's not coming to us in the way that we expect. Like, no, I want God to talk to me in this way. If there's a God, he should speak through this person, or he needs to do this, or he needs to appear in front of me. When he might actually be standing right in front of you, providing you with help, but because you are so adamant that it's your way or no way, that you are completely oblivious to the help that you're supposed to, that you are receiving. And sometimes we see this in discussions with people. I see this a lot, where people will state something as though it's a fact. And you ask them, well, is this really a fact? Where did you get this information from? Well, everybody says so. Well, is everybody right? On what basis is everybody right? There are many things that many people have been wrong about. The majority of Germans supported Hitler. Was Hitler right? No, he wasn't. The majority of Americans were totally fine with slavery when it first started. Were they right? They weren't right. So if we're going to sit there and assume that things are right because lots of people are saying it, you're not going to get anywhere very quickly. You're supposed to come back and ask the real question of what is right. But this is something that we often do. We just state something and say, obviously, this is this. No, it's not obvious. You need to ask the question of whether or not what you're thinking is truly right or wrong. There's a politician, for example, a Christian politician, who made a comment about homosexuality. And right away, the nation was up in arms, calling him bigoted and calling him homophobic and throwing all sorts of names. Instead of asking the question of, is what he said, as a genius surgeon and scientist, scientifically correct? But because they disagree with him, because they don't like where he stands, because they feel that there's a disagreement, the automatic assumption is that he must be dumb, he must be unintelligent, he must be stupid. When the real question should be, well, what is what he said, and is it true or is it false? But people, again, they come with their view as having to be right. Sometimes I'll be discussing faith with people, some people who are struggling with their faith. And they don't have a knowledge of science, and they don't have a knowledge of religion, neither. And yet they assert facts, claiming them to be facts, which are often not facts. They are simply their opinion, or their understanding, or their bias from things that they have heard. And because of it, they aren't able to approach God, because they've put a lens around themselves of, no, I can only perceive him in this way. And sometimes people going through hardships will put the blame in the wrong place. This is the problem when we view the whole world only through the lens of my ego, my position, my opinion. Look around and see who, by being self-absorbed, has become successful. find that it's extremely rare. Most of the people who are successful are people who actually cared about other people. They didn't care only about themselves and their own views. They took the time to understand other people, to understand where other people are coming from and what they're thinking. And this is particularly problematic, this issue of being self-absorbed, because we're in an era where we're encouraged to do whatever, as we said before, whatever makes you feel good. This is what you're encouraged to do. That's actually nonsensical. The focus is always now in this society on you, your thoughts, your emotions, your wants, your needs, your perception of the world. But this egoism, this self-certainty, it blinds you to the truth. Because standing before the Pharisees was the very God that they claimed to be serving. These are people who were theoretically specialists on God. And standing right in front of them was God himself, and they didn't recognize him because of their rules, their views, their opinions. For the first time in their history, somebody on his own authority, as we said, was casting out demons. He was not praying to someone else to cast out the demons. He was not getting on his knees and asking God to raise him up. He was not getting on his knees and saying, God, please deliver them. He was by his own authority saying, I command you to get out of this person, and even forgiving their sins. If you were an unbiased person standing by, you'd be in disbelief. These people who don't have the bias, these people who don't have the ego, are the people standing around. Because the people around Christ said, surely this is the Messiah. It was so obvious to them. Why? Because they weren't thinking through their scope of lens. They're looking at the facts as they are presented right in front of them. We have never seen this happen. This person is commanding them in his own name. This must be the Messiah. This must be the one. They were able to actually interpret things correctly, even more than the so-called specialists. But the Pharisees were full of themselves. They thought that they were the guardians of the law. Them and the priests thought that they had a monopoly on truth. They owned the truth. They thought that they were the ones who were permitted to interpret and nobody else. So in spite of the supernatural event in front of them, they couldn't accept it. They had hearts that were so stony that they were totally unmoved by the miraculous event that happened in front of them. And this is what happened when we are absorbed with ourselves. God himself can stand before us with the ability to heal us, and we will still reject him. Not only, though, did they find themselves unmoved, but they were able to falsely identify God as the devil. So forget not even recognizing God, but they took it a step further. The very God whom they served, they were identifying as the devil. That's exactly what they said to them. They said, no, it is by the authority of Beelzebub, the Lord of the flies, the king of the captain of the demonic hosts, that you are doing this thing. Can you imagine that? This is how irrational we can become, thinking we are being rational, where we can see something good and call it completely evil, when the real truth of the matter was that it was God standing before them. They were so ignorant that they called the person they serve their greatest enemy, and without shame or hesitation. So we have to figure ourselves out. I mean, we know other stories of people who, because of their expectations, didn't recognize when something right was happening. We have the famous story of Saint Bishoy that I'm sure you're all familiar, where the people were jealous that Saint Bishoy got to see Christ. They didn't think about why did Saint Bishoy get to see Christ. They did not think, oh, maybe I should emulate Saint Bishoy and his relationship with God. They're just angry. I want to see him too. It's not fair. Woe is me. And all sorts of self-pity. And Christ still had compassion. And he said, okay, I will allow you guys to see me on such and such day. I will come at the top of such and such hill. You will meet me. And we all know the story. They go and they find an old man at the foot of the hill begging them to carry him up to the top because he also wanted to see Christ. And each monk, one by one, refused to do anything for him, except, of course, for Saint Bishoy. And as Saint Bishoy, who himself was old, is carrying this old man up the hill, he finds him getting heavier and heavier and heavier, sees the marks of our Lord, and realizes that he saw Christ. But because the people wanted Christ in a specific way, a They wanted him in a glorious way. They wanted him to come with light and to do a spectacular show. They didn't see him. They didn't know. Because our Lord comes in peace. Our Lord comes quietly. Our Lord comes in rest. That's why he says, be still and know that I am God. That's why we see with Isaiah how it says there, the voice of the Lord was not in the whirlwind. It was not in the storm. It was not in the earthquake. It was in the still, small breeze. This is how our Lord works. But because they had their own view, that's what they wanted. And because of it, they missed out on receiving the blessings of our Lord. Judas worked through his own bias too. If Judas had stood before Christ and simply said, I am sorry, undoubtedly Christ would forgive him on the spot. Undoubtedly. He forgave Peter, who swore up and down that he didn't know him and cursed him. But Judas, in his mind, believed that there is no way that God could forgive me. His biases prevented him from experiencing the mercy of God in the flesh. Who knows what happened afterwards, but in the flesh. He had no idea. This was because he approached God with his limitations on God. There's no way that God could forgive me. He was ignorant. It was a self-pitying ego, where he felt that, No, I'm so bad, there's no way, etc., etc. Why not go up and find out for yourself? Why not deal with God directly and find out about his mercy, as opposed to making these assumptions about him? We need to drop the lenses that we put in front of ourselves and come to Christ to find out who is he. Not who you think he is, not who your biases are, not what you thought you heard about him. You need to approach Christ himself and interact with him and meet him. We might be in pain. We might have struggles, we might be intelligent, we might be anything. But approach things with an open heart and ask the right questions. Our Lord challenged them to think critically. So look at our Lord. He didn't get angry with them because of the wrong view of him. They called him a devil. Okay? They called him a devil and he's God. They called God his own arch enemy. He didn't freak out at them, he didn't scream at them, he didn't tell them that they were all ridiculous and all sorts of stuff. Instead, he challenged them to use their minds, right? He looked at them and said, okay, let's play with this logic that you have in your minds. Does this make any sense to you? That the devil is casting himself out. Does that make any sense to anybody? Because that's what you guys are trying to say. You're trying to say that I, as a devil, am doing this. So what you're saying is that there's some civil war in demon land, and that I'm doing it in God's name, making people believe in God while I am somehow a devil. Does that make sense? That's what he's saying to them. He says, okay, use your mind. This is your bias. This is what you're thinking, but you're wrong. We need to do the same thing. Sometimes God is saying, well, how about you go through your thoughts and realize that maybe what you're thinking is irrational. Look at the history. Look at my story. Look at my history with you. And ask me if this makes any sense or not. He tells them what it meant to follow that logic without getting angry. He took their reasoning and showed them what it leads to and how it wouldn't make sense. And instead shows them the right conclusion, that the kingdom of heaven is upon them. Saying that if I'm not the devil, then there's really only one other option for you to deal with. That the kingdom of heaven is truly here, that the Messiah has truly come. Because if not, I wouldn't be able to, on my own authority, do these things. That's why the two most important questions in life are, what is the truth? And the second is, what does that mean? Those are the two most important questions. What is the truth and what does that mean? Because in front of them was someone casting out devils. That was the truth. That was the fact. What does it mean? Christ answered them with what it meant. It meant that the kingdom of heaven was in front of them, that he was indeed the Messiah. Same thing with the apostles. These Pharisees came saying, they should be doing X, Y, and Z. They should be doing all these ritual practices. And what do the apostles say in return? They say, well, here's the fact of the matter. You're saying this, but the fact of the matter is the Holy Spirit came upon them anyway. What do you say to that? Like, are you greater than the Holy Spirit? And we've seen all these signs and wonders working among the Jews. So what do you say to that? That was their response. Because fact was in front of them. And what does that mean? If God himself has blessed it, then you're wrong. And that's why the apostles came to the conclusion of, no, we're not going to lay a burden on them. So here's what we all need to work on. Ask yourself and meditate during this week and beyond what are my personal biases? What is the lens through which I see the world? What are the things that I've put in front of me as my obstacles? For Judas, he didn't believe that Christ would have mercy. For the Pharisees, they didn't like that he didn't follow their rules. What are the things that prevent you from knowing God as he is? Do I know who God is? Or do I deal with him based on who I think he should be? You need to ask yourself that question. And if I don't know God, on what basis have I been dealing with him? Because maybe it's been through a wrong lens. Maybe that's been my obstacle to God. And God doesn't get angry with that, as we saw. He will work with you. He'll go through your logic and talk to you and say, no, this might be a logical habib. And he doesn't get upset. He didn't yell at them for having a wrong view. And we can be comforted by that. Open your Bibles. Open your Bibles in a non-superficial way. Open your Bibles and read and ask, who is this God when you're reading it? What does this say about him? What does this say about me? What does this say about our relationship with one another? Open your hearts to the experience of him, removing your filters, your reservations, and immerse yourself in him so that you can get a taste of his love and a taste of the experience. Go beyond the laws, go beyond the regulations, go beyond the fluff, okay, that we have surrounded our God with, and interact with him for who he really is, that he can enter and touch you in a way that you might not have been expecting. If we do this, we will also find that, as he said to them today, that we will find that the kingdom of heaven is come upon us. And glory be to our God forever and ever.